Hello and welcome to the documentary film making tutorial. I'm Lori Mitchell. I'm delighted to be a part of this wonderful experience, and I will be the lead trainer this year for the filmmaking challenge, and we'll be with you all year. During our sessions, I will guide you on how to effectively create a short documentary for this year's theme, energy infrastructure, wind, oil, and natural gas. The actual filmmaking challenge your students will solve will be unveiled via C-STEM break on Saturday, October 25th, 2014 at 10 a.m. Central Standard Time. So let's get started. A little bit about me. I currently work for an oil and gas company called Nabors Industries. We have a film department. I am partnering in the film department. I also do technical writing for them, but our film department creates corporate videos detailing the structure and the function of both oil and gas drilling rigs. Filming can be very lucrative and beneficial career in the STEM industries. Many filmmakers do not know that they're able to have a career in a film environment or a career in the corporate environment because they think that making movies is where it is, but it's not always the case. You can do creative commercials, shows, training videos, how-to videos, and the list goes on and on. So you can still be creative, but they'll just give you a specific framework to work in. More about me is I am a former high school English teacher. I also am the daughter of a semi-famous blues singer, McKinley Mitchell. And most importantly, I'm a filmmaker. A few things that I'm working on now, I'm working on a documentary for sickle cell anemia, which should be completed at the end of November. And I just recently entered a horror film festival called Splatterfest. It happens every year. And we were nominated for awards. And of course, like I said, we didn't win anything in the PowerPoint, as you can see. But it's fun to do. So whenever some of your students may want to get involved in doing some of that, or some of you guys may want to do that as well. Anyone can enter those film festivals. You just pay your entry fee, and they give you 48 to 54 hours to complete a film, and you turn it in, and you see if you can win. Okay, let's get started on some of the videos I've done. In 2010, I wrote and directed a commercial for Chloe Dow. She was the winner of season 2, Project Runway. And this commercial ran during Houston's Fashion Week. So let me go to the link now. Give me 1 second.
Je joue contre vous. Je veux jouer, joue contre vous, mais vous le voulez-vous? De tout cœur, je veux gagner ce cœur à cœur. Vous connaissez mon jeu par cœur, alors défendez-vous. Sans tricher, je vous le promets. J'ai gagné, tant pis c'est bien fait, vous êtes mon jouet. À présent, ce ne sera plus vous mais toi. Et tu feras ça, t'apprendras n'importe quoi pour moi.
Okay, now that commercial was, I believe, 52 seconds long, and that actually took us 2 days to make. So that kind of gives you an idea on filmmaking, because we had to go to different locations and get our lighting just right for the inside shots, so which are called interior shots. So just for a 52-second video, it took us 2 days, 48 hours. Okay, now I wanted to show you this video, Be Determined is a commercial, and this is like another way that you can incorporate B-roll footage or insert footage. It's a program, I created this in a program called After Effects. If any of you guys are familiar with the Adobe programs, with the Adobe Suite, it comes with the Master Suite. I think it's Photoshop, After Effects, Premiere, those things like that. So that's where this comes from. So let's watch this video. I'll pull up the link for you guys. And this is just a way to show you how you can view or create a video or a look to a video. A lot of commercials use this style and make your video interesting. So let me know when you start watching it.
I'm here at Foot Action to get styled by T.I.
I'm here today being styled by T.I.
I'm getting styled by T.I.
Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. Beyond measure.
I'm gonna show you how great I am. Last night I cut the light off in my bedroom, hit the switch, was in the bed before the room was dark. I'm gonna show you how great I am. Only last week I murdered a rock, injured a stone, hospitalized a brick. I'm so mean I make medicine.
Okay, and as you know, it cut off in the end, my fault. But it originated with finding photos and editing them in Photoshop, then going into the After Effects program and creating this look, because it allows you to do a camera type feel to it. So that's, I just wanted to educate you a little bit on other options that you can use to get your film looking a little more creative, I guess, in a sense, where you just don't have the still photos or, you know, the video. So let's get started. So one of my favorite directors, Martin Scorsese, he said this quote, "What is filmmaking? To be a writer, you need a pen. To be a painter, a brush. To be a musician, an instrument. But to be a filmmaker, you need the collaboration of others to bring your vision to canvas." That is the movie screen. And that's so true, because no person can do a film on their own. It is very difficult. You need everyone. It's a team of people. And we'll go over that later on in different trainings of the different positions that you would need when you're filmmaking. But let's go into the documentary film stages. You need the initial idea. You need your planning. You need your filming, editing, and of course screening, because someone has to watch it. So let's talk about your idea for a documentary film. A documentary film is either a representation or a presentation of information. This type of film should be about informing or persuading the audience on a topic. Documentaries also are a type of storytelling that explores factual stories and issues using film or video. So you always want to keep your audience entertained. I wanted to show you this video that I did in film school. This is like the worst example of a documentary film. I didn't understand the importance of telling a story. I thought initially when we received that assignment that particular time that, okay, if I get this guy and I interview him, this is going to be a good documentary. But what happened is that because I just filmed him, and I didn't have any additional information to go with it. The documentary came across as an advertisement for his clothing line versus an actual documentary. So this is just an example of what you should not do, because you want to keep your audience interested. So please never do this, never make a mistake. But out of every mistake, you learn something. So I know better now. Let me get the link for you guys to pull up the video. 1 second. Okay.
I used to define myself as a basketball player, but realized through the course of some experiences that basketball is what I do or what I did, not necessarily who I am.
Got total control like a puppet master. I'll be the church, let you be the pastor. And what I want, man, you know I'ma ask you. Throw a blessing like a pitcher, man, I'll be the catcher. You keep it popping like a firecracker. Used to be a thug, but you changed the stature. To steak and shrimp from cheese and crackers. Life changed every time I read a chapter.
Playing the NBA was my dream since I was 7 years old. So when the doctors initially told me that I wouldn't play anymore, it was a big shock. I was, for about 2 or 3 months, I was really depressed about it, and just went ahead and tried to get back out there. And you know, and the end result, I was able to get back on the court and play. So I just had a great satisfaction and proving the doctors wrong and proving everybody else wrong that said I wouldn't play again.
And actually, it's Lanny Smith who's in for the first time. Rookie out of Houston for Sacramento.
I had an invite to camp with the Sacramento Kings, and that's how that journey started. After I got with the Sacramento Kings, I actually experienced another injury. I tore some cartilage in my knee during a game. A guy fell into my knee, and my knee just kind of jerked inwards, and once again the doctors were telling me I would never play again. And this time around, you know, I wasn't depressed like I was about my foot. I just kind of, you know, gave it to God, and I asked him how did he want to use me, because I was like, here I am finally getting a chance in the NBA, and then this injury happens. I was confused as to what he had for my life, so I really just prayed about it, and really the idea for Active Faith, you know, was given to me out of that. Active Faith is a Christian sports apparel brand, not just basketball, but across all sports platforms. Provides fashionable sports apparel that is faith-based.
Okay, we don't have to watch it all the way to the end.
Our motto is,
but I just wanted you guys to see how that video came across so very wrong. So you just want to make sure that you have a storyline. I think had I focused either on his injury and how he overcame that, it would have been better, or just strictly focused on his clothing line, and that would have been a much better fit. But to have those two going at the same time, and then not having other people being interviewed, it just led to a very boring, not very boring, but it wasn't a documentary. Okay, so let's go to documentary terms. So footage refers to all material used in a film, including edited and unedited sequences. I don't want to go through all of the definitions, so you are able to review them at your leisure, but I wanted to present those definitions to you so you'll know if you hear me say some of these terms. I just kind of wanted you to make sure you had the definition and understanding of what I'm saying here. So let's skip on over to what makes a documentary good. So I really wanted you guys to look at this documentary. I thought this was excellent. A fourth grader did it. It has everything that you could possibly want. The exposition, the rising action, conflict, climax, falling action, resolution. It takes you on a journey. So this is a really great documentary. So I want you guys to look at this film. It's 19 minutes long. So whenever you have time to look at this film and go through what the exposition is, the rise in action, the conflict, and see if you can pinpoint what they are based on this chart that I have added here on the PowerPoint. So let's go to the next slide. So documentary techniques. Now, this video is going to tell you exactly what you need to do for interviews. A lot of time when people think about doing a documentary, they get really nervous and they start asking the interviewee, I guess, the questions like, okay, so tell me about, say, the documentary, like, okay, let's go with sickle cell. That's what I'm doing now. So tell me about your first crisis. And the person will start talking, well, you know, I remember blah, 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 blah. You never want them to do that. You want them to repeat. Well, my first crisis is, and the reasoning for that is you want it to be easy on the editor, because the editor have to be able to place the information in the right spots. So let's watch this video on documentary techniques. Let me get that link for you guys. Hold on just a second. And let me know when you start watching.
The OfficeJet Pro X manageability is what you look for in any device.
When you interview a person for a documentary, the best way to do it is this. You know, you can videotape them in their living room, you can videotape them at work, whatever, but just make sure you do it in a quiet place where you don't have any background noise, because again, you want the audio to be as good as possible. For lights, you usually have to have a big light in front of them, you know, one to kind of backlight them. It's really important that also the lights reflect in their eyes, that you have, you know, pinpricks of light in their eyes, because it just makes them seem more alive and more engaging. And they never ever should be looking at the camera. If somebody's asking them questions, the interviewer should be seated alongside the camera so that when they're talking, they're looking off to the side like this as opposed to the camera. And when they're doing the interview and when they first start talking, they'll be nervous and they'll be going like back and forth, back and forth. And you have to remind them, look at the interviewer. So it's always good to have another person there, and you put them in a chair right next to the camera so the person talking can just focus on them. And after a while, they'll forget about the camera. And because they're usually have never been interviewed at all, and this is like a whole new experience for them, they're nervous. These people are nervous. So the first couple questions you ask them again, you know, towards the end, because they'll give you much better answers. You know, they'll be more relaxed. It'll flow more. It'll be a lot better. So definitely repeat those, you know, last couple questions. In terms of the questions, I'll send them a list of what I'm going to ask them beforehand. I'll email them, you know, so they could get prepared. When they're answering the questions, since I don't have any voiceover narration and I have the people in the documentary tell the story, I'll ask them a question like, well, you know, when did you first start, you know, doing this, or when did you first start having a reaction, you know, to the disease or whatever. I'll have them paraphrase the question into their answer. So they'll kind of like, you know, rephrase it. So, you know, they'll be making a statement as opposed to, you know, sounding like they're answering the question. So that's really important, because you want them to convey all the information as clearly you know, as possible. You don't necessarily have to have a sit-down interview like what I'm doing now. You could have them, you know, you can do like a handheld interview if they're out and about, you know, at work or doing some type of sport or something. It just adds more variety rather than just have like a talking head. So the more varied, you could do both, you know, the more varied, the better.
Okay, so that was an excellent video on how to do your interviews when you're interviewing and make an interview for your documentary. Another technique is the storytelling technique. And this in this particular one, it's also going to go over the rise and action, the climax and all of that. So I definitely want you guys to pay attention to this. So give me 1 second to pull that up. Okay, let me know when you start.
No matter what role you play in a documentary, good storytelling is key. Whether you're pitching to an investor, directing a camera crew, or editing the final piece, story connects everything together and makes a project worthwhile. As with any new endeavor, starting with the basics is the key to understanding every concept that lies ahead. As such, we will be looking at how theme, motivation, and the dramatic arc, with its exposition, rising action, turning point, falling action, and denouement, work together in order to produce riveting stories.
Every good story starts with a solid theme, and documentaries are no exception. Great documentaries have a powerful underlying subject that reoccurs throughout the film. For instance, though Bowling for Columbine was a documentary exploring the reasons for shootings at a school in Littleton, Colorado, the underlying themes were human indifference, gun control, racism, and the problems of America. Of course, themes don't always stem from the people in the documentary. Even though Earth is a factual story about different areas of our world, it still had themes of environmental activism and the human qualities in nature. Overall, theme is what a movie is all about, so they give a documentary cohesion and a type of emotion.
At the same time, it is also important to know where a documentary's action is derived from, or what drives the story along. Oftentimes, the story is either plot-driven, such as in Jonestown, where the action is derived from the impending death of the townspeople, or character-driven, such as the documentary Grizzly Man, which is driven by the antics and tragedy of its subject, Timothy Treadwell. At the same time, the motivation of a documentary can come from an essay, when a documentarian seeks answers to events in our society. In New World Order, Luke Meyer seeks to understand more about conspiracies in America. Choosing what subject drives your documentary can make it easier to know what to shoot and who to interview.
Though theme and motivation are an integral part to any good story, arguably the most important concept to know about shaping a great story is the dramatic arc. The dramatic arc is the structure of how a narrative is told. It's called an arc because of its tendency to follow the natural rise and fall of a conflict in a story. There are usually 5 points to a dramatic arc, which are all crucial to an engaging and free-flowing story.
The first part of the dramatic arc is the exposition. The exposition allows an audience to get inside of a story and gives background information needed to properly understand it. Expositions introduce an antagonist, a protagonist, a setting, and a basic conflict. In The Devil and Daniel Johnston, the filmmakers give the exposition at the beginning of the film through a slideshow presentation about the subject, Daniel.
This is 6 minutes long.
The basic idea is to give the audience what they need to know.
Here, but I really want you guys to really, really take a look at the full 6 minutes of this because it goes into everything that we need to know about the storytelling process. So Let's go to our next slide, which is the documentary techniques again in information resources. So you have three different types. The factual resource, which focuses on the claims that are known to be true. These claims can be backed up with recent research, accurate data, those sort of things. Your second type of information resource is a value resource. It's nearly the exact opposite of a factual claim. The speaker or the person in the film will attempt to convince listeners or on viewers of his or her personal value judgment if it's true. So you're just pretty much, I guess, just speaking about your opinion or something. And then the policy, and they're meant to persuade the policy that should be implemented. A policy is defined as a clear solution to the type of problem with an established justification, plan, and benefit. So, and most of the time, your speaker is going to help that along. In the interview, so you want to make your questions, have them go in the direction of if you want it to be a factual thing or a value thing. So it's kind of like you're moving it along and getting to the documentary to focus on the point based on the questions that you decide for the people to answer in your interview process. And that will take us to the planning and the preparation. So it's really five steps to five elements, but we're going to focus on three to shooting a film. You have your pre-production, your production, and your post-production. So today we're going to talk about the pre-production. And you want to have, for the documentary, you want to have a script outline, which that outline will definitely focus and guide you on. It's just like a layout, just like a blueprint. If you're building a house, you have to have a base, a blueprint. So that's what your outline is doing for you. And again, you want to create your interview questions. So based on your outline, the way you want your viewers to feel, the information that you want them to know, you're going to create your interviews from that. For example, in our sickle cell anemia documentary, we're focusing on what the doctors don't know about their patients. So all of our questions are geared around the patients and their experiences when they go to the hospital, how they feel, their treatment, all of those things. So we made a clear focus, because in the beginning it was kind of like, okay, we want to talk about this, we want to talk about that, and you don't want to do that. Like I showed you in the student film documentary, you want to have a clear focus. So that's where your interview questions and your shot list is just going to show how you want your film to look. And we'll go over that in a second. Create a production schedule. You want to always be organized. So if you're going to shoot internally, you want to try to do those shots last. If you're going to do externally, you want to do those first, because you don't want to be outside in this Houston heat in the middle of the day. So you want to do the hardest shots first and the easiest shots last. And you can organize yourself by saying, okay, we're going to do all external shots from 7 a.m. to 10 a.m. We're going to do all internal shots from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. You can do your production schedule like that. Create an equipment list. You want to have your cameras, lights, tripods, mics, whatever it is you need. You need to always have that listed so you don't forget anything when you go on set to start shooting. gathering additional footage. Now that, you want to do that, but that's pretty much when you get into the editing process, but you still want to know where you're going with your film and what your B-roll footage and your stock footage is going to be. So that should be included in your outline. So you'll kind of have, again, your blueprint. And the music, you want to use music from an unknown artist unless you get permission from that person. So that's why it's in the pre-production process, so that you can get those permissions. So at the end, when you're editing, you don't have to wait on someone to say, oh, you can use my music. No. So these are all the steps for pre-production. As I said before, the script outline, it just goes over what your film is going to be about. So that's what that is. Creating an interview and shot list. So when we just watched a film on the interviews, and that went over that, but I want to focus on, make sure that you say who, what, answer who, what, where, when, why, and how. You always want to give as much information, as possible out of your interviews, so that you can have that footage for your editor to know which direction that they're going in. Because sometimes you may be going in one direction and it's great, you have your outline, but your editor may find something that can make your story better based on the additional information that your interviews give. And that also is, again, based on the questions that you have answered. And you always want them to answer with complete sentences, as I said before. Your shot list should include your shot number, your camera angles, and your camera movement. So here's an example. To your left, you have your shot number, which is saying, okay, my first shot, number 1 or 3, 11, 7. So that's the order that is going to go in. The duration of the seconds of the shot, meaning, you know, how long does it take you to get the shot. Your shot type, and those are just abbreviations of the angle and the angle and the shot look. So we're going to go over that in a second as well. And then the movement, we'll talk about that later on, the zooming and tracking and all those things. So you don't have to have the action detail, but it's always good. So if you're doing a medium shot, which would be the MS, and then you want it to be eye level. So a medium shot, eye level, and you want to say that, okay, I want to do a track. A tracking shot is when you take the camera and you follow the person. You follow either in front of them or behind them with the camera. And you can put in your action, okay, we're going to follow this person down X, Y, and Z street. So you can, that person is either walking or running. That's how you want to include your action detail. You don't always have to do that, but to make your director of cinematographer and your camera person know exactly what's going on, I would suggest to do it. To your right, you see your storyboard, and your storyboard is another way to help you. So it'll be a drawing with the detailed information. A lot of times it'll have the shot type on there, but because you're looking at the storyboard, it should be drawn out. It doesn't have to be perfect, but it should be drawn out well enough to know, okay, this is going to be a medium shot, this is going to be a close-up shot, so that your cinematographer will know. And the cinematographer is just the person who makes your film look a certain kind of look away. Like the lighting, they're in charge of the look of the film. So let's go to the next slide. So here are the terms. Establishing shot, the abbreviation for that is ES, and that's like the beginning of the film. So when you first thing that came to mind, I don't know if any of you guys used to watch Family Matters. When that show first came on, there would be the shot of the house, and then it would go into the show. That's your establishing shot. It's just letting you know where you are, where the action is about to take place. A full shot, it incorporates the whole body. So you'll just see all of the person from head to toe in a full shot. A medium shot, it goes from the waist up. You don't want to cut the person off at the elbows because it makes it look awkward on camera. A close-up shot would show you the person's face, just a close-up shot of their face, just their face. And then an extreme close-up shot is normally like their eyes, where you're trying to get a certain kind of emotion out of that person. And a lot of times, if you watch a film, a close-up shot will make you be emotional. If that person is crying or something just happened, you would definitely use a close-up shot for that. And over-the-shoulder shot is just what it says. You have the camera over the other person's shoulder. You're seeing the image of that person, and the camera is half of the person that they're talking to. It's like two people in a frame. Half of the person's shoulder is in that frame, and normally it's like behind the second person. And I'll show you in here what these shots look like. Now, other helpful terms is the 180 rule. And that rule is, if you have a person on the left side of the frame, if you decide to turn the camera around, that person should now be on the right side of the frame, because you still want to establish that that person is in that position of the film. If that person is on the left side of the frame and you turn the camera around and you put them on the left side of the frame again, it looks weird. And I will show you an example of that later, because it's difficult to understand without visually seeing it. And it took me forever to understand the 180 rule. And that's how people can tell an amateur filmmaker from an actual real filmmaker, is definitely when they jump the 180 line. And we'll talk about that more in detail later, because I don't want to confuse you guys. And inserts, those are just like clips, B-roll footage, things like that. So if you're interviewing someone and they start talking, maybe they picked their nose, or, you know, they did something quirky, you want to use an insert shot to kind of cover that up so that the audience do not see that. Okay, so let's go to the next slide. So here are the visuals of the shot. So an extreme close-up is what I'm saying. What I was saying earlier, when a person is crying or they're sad or happy, if you really want to get that emotion, you want to do an extreme close-up shot. Close-up shots does the same thing, but the extreme close-up give you a better gauge at what's going on. Medium shot, if you're noticing, like I said, you don't want to cut them off at the elbows, but it's like right in the middle of their chest. So that's like a perfect medium shot there. There's another medium shot. They did not cut them at the elbow. They went below in the middle of their forearm. There's a two-person medium shot. And then you have an over-the-shoulder shot, and that, again, as you can see, the person, it's supposed to be the person's shoulder, but you really can't see the shoulder in here. But you see that it is over the camera is over the shoulder of another person, because you see the back of her head. All right. So in the equipment checklist, you want to make sure, like I said, you have all your equipment. So this is a great example of equipment checklist. You have the audio, the video, the lighting. And you're just going over your video, what you have for the camera, if you have your tripod, if you're using like a DSLR camera, which is those Canon cameras like a 60D or T2i, you want to make sure you have an SD card for that. If you're using a cell phone, whatever kind of camera that you're using, you want to make sure you have the proper equipment that goes with that. Under video, you want to make sure that you have all your audio, and then you want to make sure that you have all your lighting equipment. So just the equipment checklist is perfect so that you don't miss anything when it's time to shoot. All right, so that's the end of my training session, and thanks for attending. Let me know if you have any questions. I will add more information on my C-STEM break page, so feel free to leave me a message at any time. But I also want you guys to know that all of my training information will be shared on the C-STEM break. All of my Saturday workshops will take place on C-STEM break. Also, 90% of all communication to teachers and students will take place on the C-STEM break platform. So you're able to blog. We really want you guys to blog, share, research, upload pictures and videos. Just really use the C-STEM break site to do all communication. Here's a view of our academic year calendar. So take a look at that, review that so you can know what's going on for the rest of our time. And also, before you go, to complete your training, please join the 2015 TTI group on C-STEM break to answer discussion questions in the filmmaking discussion thread. You will be provided certificate in acknowledgement on your completion of the two-hour training for your records. Also, remember to plan your C-STEM challenge kickoff activities on your campus. The challenge will be unveiled Saturday, October 25th at 10 a.m. So plan something fun and exciting. After the kickoff, I will see you and your students at your first Saturday workshop, which will be November 15th. On the C-STEM break. So let's make this a great year, guys. Thanks.